So next topic for today is hydrostatic exclusion. So what is hydrostatic? We have been discussing exclusion in the previous lectures also. So next sort of exclusion is that is your hydrostatic exclusion. So what is it? In hydrostatic exclusion, the billet is surrounded with fluid inside the container and the fluid is pressurized by the forward motion of the ram. So here we see, this is the billet, clear? So it is being surrounded by the fluid, clear? And this is the fluid in this case. This is working billet, this is fluid, and this is all over contained in a container. And it is being pushed by the action of ram, clear? So pressurized by the forward motion of ram. There is no friction inside the container because of the fluid, and friction is minimized at the die opening. So what is happening in this case? Previously we were discussing that the issue was that due to the contact of container and the billet, basically here is the presence of friction in the previous cases, and that too leads to the defects in the extrusion process of the final product. So in this case we have taken off the contact and that we can say due to the presence of friction the surface quality was disturbed in the previous case. So in this case what is happening is we have replaced the contact with the fluid. So if the presence of fluid makes the your surface as frictionless, clear? So the removal of friction from here makes it the operation to be smooth, and the defects of the surface contact is being eliminated in this process. If used at high temperature, special fluids and procedures must be followed. So if we normally, like we all know, there are three types of working: cold working, warm working, and hot working. So if it is the case of cold or warm working, then it is okay. So then we can use a normal fluid. But if we are working on, we can say hot working, so then we have to use the special fluid. Special fluid, I mean to say, in this part is like they should have their resistance for high temperatures. Yeah, so they can sustain their, we can say, viscosity or fluidability at high temperatures. Clear? Then hydrostatic pressure on the work and no friction situation increases the material's ductility. So what happens is due to this hydrostatic pressure, clear? So because of this, the friction is not there and the ductility of the material is also improved in this case. Hence, this process can be used on metals that would be too brittle for conventional extrusion process. So due to its ability to impart ductility, this process can also be used for brittle materials. Clear? Because the brittle material, although if we are doing with a normal extrusion process or conventional extrusion method, what will be happening in this case, there will be friction, and due to the brittleness of that material may, we can say, worn off, or it can fail, clear, due to its due to brittle nature. So when we are using this hydrostatic extrusion, there it increases the ductility of that metal, and it can help also in, we can say, extrusion of brittle materials. This process is also applicable for ductile metals, and here high reduction ratios are possible. So this process normally we can use for ductile metals also, and there is reduction ratio, the rate of reduction ratio in this case is very high, because they can easily be extruded in the hydrostatic extrusion because of there is absence of friction in this case. So when there is absence of friction, so we can say reduction rates eventually automatically will go up only because more metal can be extruded because of, we can say, absence of friction in this case. The preparation of starting billet is very important. So the billet must be formed with a taper at one end to fit tightly into the die entry angle so that it acts as a seal to prevent leakage through the hole or die. So the main problem over this is that here it is to be, the preparation of a billet is very important in this case. So we see this taper on upper side and on lower side. So this taper is very important. The taper is to be provided to prevent the leakage of the fluid from the container. Yes. if the container goes like the, if the there is a leakage in the container, the fluid will come out, and the we can and the pressure that we are applying from the ram from the behind will not be sustained because of the leakage. If there is leakage, the pressure will not be developed, so as the billet will not move forward. And if the billet is will not move forward, then the, we can say the final extrusion process will not be taking place because of the required unavailability of required force from the ram, and that can only be provided if the fluid is, we can say, none of the fluid is leaked, or then there is no leakage of the fluid. So to and to prevent that leakage of the fluid, what we are doing, we are giving in taper on both the sides, like on the upper end and the lower end. Here the taper is provided just to seal the fluid from moving out of that container. Here, then now next we come for your defects during extrusion. So now we have almost completed the extrusion. We know the processes involved in extrusion. We know the, we can say, the fundamentals of extrusion. We know the angles, die angles. We know the process of dies. We know clear. So when now the next part is that when the product is made, or when the part is produced, manufactured, fabricated, clear, then what will if the what are the possible defects that can occur during the extrusion process? So one of this is your center burst. So this is an internal crack that develops as a result of tensile stresses along the center axis of the workpiece. So what is happening in this case, that there is internal, like where it is being shown, this is sort of a center burst. This is at the we can say internal crack in this case, and that is due to basically the tensile stresses along the center axis of the workpiece. Because when there is extrusion, we are pushing it from behind, and this the, it is coming in this direction, let us say. So what will be happening on the center axis, like here is the center axis for this, on the center axis due to the tensile forces, because some of the part is pushed in the opposite direction, and some of the part in the x direction, and some of the in the backward direction. So what will be happening in this case, there will be the, we can say, generation of tensile stresses at this region. So when there is generation of tensile stresses at this region, so this will be taking off your burst at the center line out of this. So burst over center line is, what will be happening at this stage is that due to the burst, there will be, we can say, spots, or the material will be taken off nearby the center line of this. A large material motion of the outer region pulls the material along the center of the work. Beyond a critical limit, bursting occurs. So what is happening when there is motion of material? Motion of material means the material is being pushed from the backward. The billet is pushed from the backward by the ram, and from this end of this die, it is coming out. Clear? So what is, there is pull of a material. Basically, there is a motion of material going over this. So this, there is basically pulling of material over this part. So after, before out of the die, clear, the material is being pulled out, and that along the center of the work, the pulling, maximum pulling is taking place. So although the material to material, it retains up to certain limit, clear, so that we can say the bursting do not occur. But when that temperature or the critical point basically of that load or the motion of material goes up beyond that part, there is, we can say, bursting is at that place. In this case, conditions that promote this defect are higher die angles. When we put on higher die angles, that can also result in your center burst. Then low extrusion ratios. Low extrusion ratios means amount of billet is being, material that is of the billet is being large, that to the extrusion of that. Then impurities in the work metal, clear. So when there is impurities in the work metal also, like if the material is an alloy, or we are having an impurities over this. So what happens is, when there is pushed by the material of the billet from the ram, what happens, that presence of impurities don't let that material to move on the motion in this case. So when that impurities occur, the movement of material doesn't take place. And due to that movement, of preventing that material from we can say displacing. What happens is that it results in your central burst voltage. Clear? Then next one is your piping. So in case of piping, what is there? It is the formation of sink hole in the end of the billet. This is minimized by usage of dummy block whose diameter is slightly less than that of the billet. So this is basically a sink hole type. Like this is the piping. We see over this here. So we see over this part there is a sink hole at the end of the billet, and that can be it can be prevented by, we can say, by putting a dummy block here. So we put a dummy block on the we can say billet whose diameter is slightly less than that of the billet. So what we do that, like when it is pushing, we put it slightly less than the over this, like we put a micrometers of this or this, and this slightly less than that of this diameter, we put in dummy block, and when it goes off the like this, so it comes out easily, and as it is, it goes in straight motion over this. The motion of material goes in a straight line upon this through this. Clear? And so this, that prevents this, we can say, piping of the material or the sink hole during this part of this your extrusion over this. Then third one is your surface cracking. The defect results from high workpiece temperature that causes cracks to develop at the surface. So what happens in this case is, like when we are working on warm working, we can be hot working. So what will be happening over this time, there is very like we are working on a very high temperature range. Clear? So that will be due to that, we can say, high temperature zone, there will be the we can say presence of, or the cracks, it causes cracks on the surface of that material. Clear? They, and if, and also if we are going on a very high extrusion speed plus we are on the high temperature range, then also there are chances of surface cracking also, because if the motion of the ram is very fast. Clear? So what will be resulting in this, the material of this is extruded very fast also from that part also. Clear? So what is happening over this, that we, and that we are working on a high temperature zone, high temperature area, then there will be the surface cracking of that material. So higher friction at the surface and surface chilling of high temperature billets in hot extrusion also cause this defect. One another cause of this can be high friction at the surface when the material is being extruding from the die. So if there is the presence of high friction, where the friction is very high, so then also there will be chances that the surface will crack while coming out of that die, or surface chilling of high temperature billets in hot extrusion. So we will be talking of hot working. So when we are doing hot extrusion in this case, so what will be happening, the surface when it comes out gets cooled. Here, when it comes out of that die, it gets cooled, and when it gets cooled, suddenly over this, there are also chances of surface cracks on this to be visible on that gives the formation of cracks on the surface, because there is instant chilling of this. So surface chilling can also lead to your surface cracking in this case. So these are the three common defects, that is central burst, piping, and surface cracking in this case. Now, next is your wire rod and bar drawing. So, wire drawing, rod drawing, or bar drawing we are talking about. Now, this is also a bulk forming process. Here, a wire, a rod, or a bar are pulled through a die hole, reducing the cross sectional area. Here, so in this case, also we are pulling this, you can say, a wire or a rod or a bar, and that through a die hole to reduce its surface area or cross sectional area. So what is happening in this case, we are reducing this area by pulling it out. Yeah, so this is the billet, this is we can say previous diameter, and this is final diameter for this. So what is happening, this is your draw die, clear? And this is angle for this, we can say length of that taper upon this. So when it is being pulled out in this direction, clear, like the force we are seeing in this direction, so that reduces, that there is reduction in diameter from D0 to DL. Clear? So this is basically your wire, rod, or bar drawing in this case. Now, what is the difference between wire drawing and rod drawing? So we use these terms interchangeably many times. So what is the basic difference between them is that the basic difference between the bar drag and wire drag is the stock size. Clear? The stock size means the use of billet basically that is used for forming. Bar drag is meant for large diameter bar and rod diameter, while wire drag is meant for small diameter stock. So bar drag is for, we can say, a large diameter bar, like we are talking for a bar that will be having a larger diameter. And when we are taking for your wire drawing, so there will be the diameter of the stock will be smaller. Obviously, we are talking, we have to create a bar, then the diameter of the stock D naught will have to be more than in case of we are going for a wire drawing in this case also. Wire sizes are of the order of 0.03 mm are produced in wire drawing. So wire sizes, if we call, we can generate, produce upon zero, that is 0.03 millimeter, then we can produce by wire drawing in this case. Operating stages is, bar drag is generally done as a single stage operation in which stock is pulled through one die opening. The inlet bars are straight and not in the form of coil, which limits the length of the work that can be drawn. It necessitates a batch type operation. So in this case, it is a single stage operation and the stock is pulled. This is your starting stock and the stock is pulled in this case, here in this direction, here. So through the die opening, the inlet bars are straight and not the form of coil. The inlet bars like this in the case are straight and not in the form of coil. So it basically limits also the length up to which we can say the bar can be taken out for that case. This necessitates a batch type operation for this. In contrast, wire is drawn from coil, like in this case it is drawn from bullet or bars. Clear? So in contrast, wire is drawn from coils consisting of several hundred meters of wire and is drawn through a series of dies. Clear? So as we know, in the case of your wire drawing, it will be taking out from the, we can say, coils, and that can be a several hundred meters of wire and drawn through a series of dies, like one die, two die, three die, like from the series of die, the number of the, we can say, the diameter of that wire goes on decreasing as it passes on from, we can say, consequent dies one after the another. The number of die varies between 4 and 12. Now between from 4 to 12, we can put the number of die. This term is known as continuous drying because of the long production runs that are achieved into wire coils. So it is normally, when it is being used for your, it also called as continuous drying, and because it is being used for when we need for a long production run for this, and are achieved through wire coil. The segments can be butt welded to next to make the operation truly continuous. So we can, when after the production, we can weld it with a, we can say, butt weld with the next lot, so that to make it a truly continuous process after one is cut off. So we can again join by welding with this, so the process becomes continuous in this case. So simple analysis of wire drying. Two strain in drying wire under ideal deformation, no friction and redundant work is given by, that is, two strain is equal to natural log of A0 upon AF. Clear? So a previous area, final area, then that is, under ideal deformation, the stress required in a wire is given by your sigma d, that is y bar f natural log of a naught upon af, where y bar f is equal to v that we have studied in the previous also, that is k 2 strain into 1 plus n, where y bar is the average flow stress corresponding to strain in the above equation. So in order to consider the effect of die angle and friction coefficient on the drying stress, K has proposed another equation as shown is, that is, sigma d is equal to y bar f 1 plus mu upon tan alpha pi natural log of theta upon k naught upon kf. Sorry. So this is basically, when we see, this is your angle for this. This is alpha here, and this is the length of this taper, that is le in this case. If you take it as one of this. Clear? So here pi is term that accounts in homogeneous deformation, which found by following equation for round cross section. To calculate pi, basically that is in homogeneous deformation, pi is taken as 0.88 plus 0.12 d upon lc. Here this is lc. Here d is an average diameter of the workpiece, lc is a contact length of work with a die given by this. So this is contact length, lc, and d is an average diameter for this. So d is equal to d naught plus df, d final, the average of two. Then lc can be taken off if we get to calculate this, d naught minus df upon 2 sine of alpha. Alpha is the angle of this tapered by this. This is basically alpha, this one. Clear? So the power required for drying is given by multiplying drying force with exit velocity of the workpiece. So if we are to get to calculate the power required for drying, then it is given by multiplying drying force and with the exit of velocity, the exit velocity of the workpiece. So we have to, if we are in the power required, then we have to multiply drying force into exit velocity. Now drying equipment, we see drying bar by draw wedge. So here we see hydraulic cylinder, carriage, drawn bars, die stand, starting work, entry table. So this is the entry table. From here it is entering over this, and this is exit rack. So it gets out of, this is die stand, and it goes from in like this. It is drawn from this part. These are drawn bars. These are entry bars for this. So these are taken over this, and these are then put on the carriage, and they are pushed pulled from this side upon this, and it passed to carriage. This is hydraulic cylinder that is doing the part of, we can say, pulling it out of this. So inlet wire stock in coil form, like here it is in the form of coil, and then it is pulled from lubricating box drawn die. Clear? The diameter is reduced from this to this. Clear? It is being pulled over this, then again another it gets to from internal wire stock, then it goes to from this wire stock to this, and again the diameter, again it is drawn, and the diameter gets reduced from this size to this side. And this is a continuous drying of wire, means it goes on drying and drying, unless the and these dies may vary from 4 to 12, like minimum 4 and maximum it can go to 12. That depends upon the final, we can say, diameter that is required for us, or the starting diameter of the stock. Clear? Because the starting diameter of the stock is also important, because we know if the starting diameter of the stock is, we can say, of a larger size, then it will be also take time to reduce the diameter in dies, because we cannot go for like a very large cut of, we can say, diameter of we can say drawing a diameter in a single die only. So that is to be done in the steps, clear, and that too one by one. So that is the issue for this. So we need to take it off one by one, and to take it off, so that there will be, we can show, it is a gradual decreasing of the diameter with one or the another die over this case. So this is the example of your continuous drawing of wire in this case. Now then it is your drawing dies. So what are the drawing dies in this case? The entry region is generally a bell-shaped mouth that does not conduct does not contact the workpiece. Clear? The entry region here, it is the entry. We see, clear? It is a bell shape, like here it is the shape of the bell, if you talk of like this. This shape and this shape is a sort of a bell. Clear? That does not contact the, there is no contact with the workpiece at this time. Over the entry, there is no contact. Its function is to contain and push the lubricant into the die. So it has to contain or push the lubricant into the die from the entry. And that is to prevent the wearing of work and die surfaces. So what is it doing? That to prevent the wearing of die, here we put on the lubricant so that die is prevented, and we can say there is no wearing of the workpiece or the billet that is in here. The approach region is where, this is the approach region, this part. Here, so this is the approach region is where the drying operation occurs. So here is the drying actually going on. It is cone shaped with an angle, half angle normally ranging from 6 to 20 degrees Celsius. Sorry, Chelsea. So the bearing surface, this is approach from 6 to 20 degrees is there upon this. Clear? Then there is the bearing surface or land. This is the bearing surface for this. And that is to be because that is the load bearing area. Determine the size of the final drawn in the workpiece. So that is the final size of the workpiece is taken upon this. So finally the back release is an exit zone. This is the entry zone. Clear? This is the approach angle for this. This is the entry zone. This is the contact for this. This is basically decides the final diameter of the block. And this is the back release from where it comes out, or we can say this is exit of that billet or wire or the billet out of this. Or this particular case,